Don't call me Scarface. My name is Capone. C-A-P-O-N-E, Capone. Yeah, my name is Dennis Al Capone, you know, and I don't chew stone, I don't walk alone, okay?
All right. All right, Dennis, we'll start. Tell us a little bit about how you first came into the music business, sound system in particular.
Well, originally I'm from Crooked River, as you can see the river rolling up there, you know, Clarendon, right? I went to Kingston at a very young age, and I was really and truly overcome by music. You know, music was my first love, really, you know, and I used to be living on Walton Park Road, nearby 28A Dance Hall, right? So we used to go there and watch the sound stringing up people like Duke Reed, Sir Coxon, King Edwards. Them time, Coxon had Stitch, Edwards had Opton, and Lord Comic sometime, and sound would come in like Sir Percy. Well, in them days, it was really the nice days of dancehall, right? Because what I used to love about it most of all is smelling the curry goat cooking. You know what I mean? Watching the people decorating the dance gate with lovely coconut bow and thing like that, right? Lovely pepper light bulbs, and listening to the when they string up the sound, the first thing you could hear is when a DJ is scratching the needle, that means they're ready for action, right? And those things used to fascinate me so much, right? So I would stay out there and listen because I didn't have money to pay going. The only time I would go in is jump the fence late.
And one sec. And hold tight. And roll.
Yeah, when the dance get nice and you'd have the peanut man outside and sell him like a peanut and the cane man and thing, I sell him cane. I know as BT have some youth out stand up at the sidewalk and make some wicked skank. Right? You have a youth named Dello. Just a watch him a dance, man, may I tell you. The real deal, you know? Got them guys that could have really dance. So we have entertainment outside and inside, you know, enough excitement. Then, well, if it's Duke Reed playing next, you'll see Duke Reed drive up in him fishtail car, right? Come out with him gun on him side and walk going to the dance hall and stay for a while. Listen to the sound if it a play good. If it nice, him, him walk around the bar and buy one and two man some drinks and then him just leave. And dance nice, right? And well, like I say, from them times, I was fascinated by the music. Well, I get into it now with El Paso, right? Around about 1968, 67, 68, right? We was we had a circle sound. We decided to build up. We start from a little puppy until it turned big dog. You know what I mean? Right? Because when we start originally, we didn't have any speakers of our own, right? And our preamp was on a sardine tin, right? So you must know how small it was, right? We started with something like some 10-inch speakers, right? So when we play out in the open, it wouldn't sound good, right? We have to go indoors to get a good sound. We get pure noise in it. Anyway, we started borrowing speakers from some guys that live on Burton Avenue, right? They had another sound system. So when we get a job to play, we'd borrow speakers and go out and do the job. And then people said, well, El Paso sound nice. You know what I mean? And from there, now the jobs keep coming in. Well, playing the sound system, I didn't actually make a name for myself as yet because people just used to call me Paso, you know? And one night, a sound came to play on Burton Avenue named Kentone, right, with a DJ named Pompadour. And listening to Kentone playing, right, and watching Pompadour selecting, right, because those days it wasn't more than one selector. The selector do everything, right? Select the music, your DJ, stringing up the sound, right? So while he was playing, he was dancing across to the record box, right, with the mic in his hand, right, and putting on the record them with some lovely movements, you know, and some real nice sounds, right? And that inspired me so much, right? Just watching him working that night, right? And I used to go and watch Uri play King Tubbies, right? And in them days, right, up till now, I never hear a better sound than King Tubby's sound system. That was the sweetest sound in the whole wide world, right? Uri had this echo thing on it. That's when he said, when he's introducing a music or advertising a dance, right? Like him said, this coming Saturday night, night. All road lead to the place called Oakland Crescent, you know, and really fascinating, you know, blow my mind, right? And Tubby's was the first one that introduced reverb in the dance hall as well, because I didn't hear anything like that. Reverb was more or less in the studios, right? But he had the reverb and the sound system and the echo, right? And it was just brilliant, you know, and the way how they set up the sound system. You know, you'd have one big steel on up in the tree, right, at the front, two on the gateposts, right, and some heavy duty speakers at the front. And in the night when the music is playing, it's, and the breeze is blowing, it's out of sight. You know, it used to be real nice. So, now, like I say, from listening to Pampaduno that night, right, it's like something was born inside of me, you know, right? Because I started working on the mic now. And what I was doing now, everybody loved it, you know? And it reached a stage now where I was mashing up the place, you know, taking over the whole Kingston 13 era, right? No sound contest, El Paso, right? You had other sounds in the era like King Prof with a DJ named Brother. You have Babsy was just in front of him on the Spanish Town Road, right? Sir Percy used to come in the era on Sunday nights with Prince Ruff at the control, right? But it was only one El Paso, right? And while DJing the sound, Keith Hudson, the great late Keith Hudson, came to me one day and said, I want you to do some recording for me, you know, because a year, so you're bad, you know? Because them time, Keith Hudson did record Uri with a song named Dynamic Fashion Way, and Ken Booth, Old Fashioned Way Rhythm, right? So anyway, I went down by Keith Hudson record shop in, he was in Parade at the time, near Joe Gibbs. Joe Gibbs didn't have this big record store that is beside Randy's at the moment. Joe Gibbs had a small thing like Keith Hudson, right? And at the time, you had people like Nicky Thomas was working for Joe Gibbs, and Prince Francis, which was one of my second, right? They used to carry on the records for Joe Gibbs. And Keith Hudson's shop was just in front of King Street on the corner of Parade there, right? In Bidim's records. So we used to be there in the daytime and hanging out, you know, right? And I did this song for him named Maca Version, which was my first record, right? He wanted me to do El Paso, right? But El Paso originally was done on a Treasure Isle rhythm in the dance hall named You Don't Care, right? That is the rhythm that I made that lyrics for. But Hudson had this rhythm and he wanted me to do it. So I just do it on the rhythm, even though I didn't feel comfortable doing it on that rhythm because I wanted the You Don't Care rhythm, right? So anyway, I did that song for him and it get a good little go, you know, but it was a hit, instant hit, right? Until I did Spanish Amiga. Hook, line and sinker, hook back Spanish Amiga, plate back jack, and the same old fashioned way, rhythm that Uri had done dynamic fashion, right? So that one now went into the charts, and but I used to record at that time as with my real name, right? And I did quite a few tracks for him, like Shades of Hudson and quite a few more what I can remember offhand, right? And then I left and went to Studio One, Coxon. And I did Nanny Version. Right, when I did Nanny Version, now I changed my name to Dennis Alcapone, right? And it was an instant hit. You know, the name, everything, the record, everything. Because when that record came out, I remember one day I was downtown, right? And one of my friends drive up in a van and decided to give me a lift home. So there was a few other guys in the van, right? And one of them said, yeah, you write a new tune, right? And the other one said, no. He said, you want to hear this tune or you write the man? It's wicked. So that time I keep quiet still enough, right? But I let them know, says me, you know? He said, tune him, Nanny Version, man. Tune bad, right? Shy, I suppose shyness as well, you know? I didn't say anything. So anyway, from Nanny Version now, we went on to Home Version and Baby Y Version and so on, right? Another good thing going with Coxon at the time. So Duke Creed now heard about me now, right? And for somehow Duke Creed thought that Uri had helped me on the records, right? So Duke Creed sent call me, right? And say, Dennis, tell me the truth, right? Them records, Uri help you, don't? I said, no, Mr. Reed, it's me, you know? He said, no, man, Uri help you with them records, man. I said, no, it's me. Right, anyway, he said, Mr. Smith have a song for me to do. Mr. Smith is the engineer at the time, Baron Smith, Duke Reed's engineer. So I did a song for him named Mosquito One, right? And the Nora, the Bob Wire rhythm, right? And that sold a lot as well, right? And after that now, I went down by Bonnie Lee. As you know, me and Bonnie Lee is brethren, right? Me and Bonnie Lee are sparring thing, and we do quite a few tune. We did Delroy Wilson, the late great Delroy Wilson, did a tune named Better Must Come, right? And I did the version to it, It Must Come, which was a big seller, right? I think Bonnie Lee did give it to him brother, Dan Lee, to put out. Right, and I was working from Striker Lee to Studio One to Duke Reed now. Right, because you know, in the record business in them days, there wasn't a lot of money going around, right? It's like praise without raise, right? So what we did really is to kind of fill up a pocket away, we have to do tune for everybody, you know, to one cocoa full basket, as they say, right? That's why a lot of people wondering why Jamaican artists record for so much producers, right? But the reason for that is because the money is so small. You have to do more than one tune. Sometime for the weekend, one artist have six tunes coming out, right? That is to make certain that you have some money in your pocket at the end of the day. Because one man could forget a sad story and tell a swelling boy, come back tomorrow, or, you know what I mean? So if you put your egg in a more than one basket, then eventually you might collect something at the end of the day, right? Anyway, from that now, Duke Reed sent call me one day and tell me that he want me to do a song for him, right? And I went and I did this tune for him, Teach the Children, which was an instant hit. You know, number one on both radio station, RGR and JBC. And from that, there was no looking back really. You know, I was working with Duke Reed now on a full-time basis because Duke Reed used to pay me weekly wages. You know, I was in the studio night and day with him, right? And I remember one day we was in the tune in the studio along with Mark West. You know, Mark West now was a man that was working full-time as well, right? And Errol, that time Baron Smith had left, right? Yeah, Baron Smith had left and have his own record shop and liquor store going up by Mullins Road. So it was Errol Brown was the engineer now. And we were in the studio and they were mixing a song, right? And I was sitting beside the mixing board and Mark was standing behind Errol and Duke Reed was sitting over the other side beside the dub machine. Anyway, something wasn't right with the song while they were mixing it. And Juke, we take out him gun, you know, right? And fire shot right beside me, right on my foot, right? And when the fire shot, him said, that damn rat. Right, there was no rat there, you know what I mean? Right? But it's Juke that over and over. When he is not pleased with certain things, him just lick two shots up in the air or whatsoever, you know, and get certain man jumpy, you know. Right? So anyway, at that time, now Derek Harriet asked me to do a live performance for him up by VIP, this club in Halfway Tree. Right? So I went and performed with Chosen Few and Tinger Stewart and a few others was there, Boris Gardner, band and thing. And this man was there now, Sparrow, the mighty Sparrow manager, was at the club tonight, and he heard me. So he said that he wanted me to go on tour in the Caribbean, a Caribbean tour with the Boris Gardner happening. So we went to Guyana, right? This was 1971. We went to Guyana and we had a good thing going until there was some little misunderstanding with management over there. And I think the rest of the tour was canceled. We do most of the tour, most of the shows in Guyana. We work in Mackenzie, in Burbese, and Georgetown, right? All in all, we had a good time. And in the marketplaces, like how we'd have Coronation Market in Jamaica, where the Igla them sell a lot of yam and banana and thing. Now, in Guyana, in their market, is pure gold. You know what I mean? So we just go into the market and put enough ring on our finger and chaps and chain and thing and come back to Jamaica. And back in Jamaica now, I did, John Holt did a song named Stick By Me, right? Which was a hit. Then I versioned it under Jumping Jack for Bonnie Lee, which was another hit for myself, you know? Yeah, there was another producer on the scene, which was a good friend of mine as well, Lee Scratch Perry, because my man Bonnie Lee used to spar, you know? Right, and Scratch, now, I did a song for Bonnie Lee named Ripe Cherry, right? And the Cherry Baby Rhythm, right? That Eric Donaldson done. Right, that was a festival song, and them song was mashing up the place at the time. Well, Scratch now wanted a version of that song, right? So he took Lizzie, another DJ, which is my friend, into the studio to do that song at Randy's studio. Well, Lizzie just couldn't get the tune right the day, right? So Scratch, I was trying to direct Lizzie from behind the engineer board, so Squat said to me, Dennis, go around and show him. You know, so I went around the mic and actually was showing Lizzie how to do the song. And Squat said, it's all right, man, go on and do it, right? And Lizzie, you can come around back. So I eventually ended up doing the song. I didn't want to do it because I already done a version for Bonnie Lee that Dynamics put out. So I didn't really want to do I'm Well Dread, but I was just showing Lizzie how to do the song, you know? And Scratch take it and put it out, right? And I did master key for him, yeah?
What was Scratch like in those days, in the studio?
Yeah, man, Scratch was very creative, you know? Very, very creative, right? And he's always have some idea going, you know? Always telling you something new to do. Right, and I did Alpha and Omega for him. This was on the Junior Biles Beat Down Babylon rhythm. Say me no like them kind of Babylon, cause I'm a righteous man and I'm a conscious man. Yeah, right. Them two was hits, you know. And but in the early days, as you know, Scratch was a recording artist too. You know, we did quite a few songs at Don't Beat, right. And I used to listen to Scratch a lot. People like Scratch, Prince Buster, Derek Morgan, when they had them thing going about blackhead Chinaman and thing like that, because them guys used to rule the roost in the early days, you know. Eric Morris, Winston Samuels, Jimmy Cliff, and all them guys, you know. Too numerous to mention, right, at the time, right? Those are the people I was listening to, right? Alton Ellis, Owen Gray, all of them, man. Larry Lakin, because I can't remember when I was a youth, right? I used to walk about 6 miles just to punch the jukebox, right? Larry Lakin had a song named Little Sheila, right? And the whole of my little chopping them, you know what I mean? Go on that song. You know, so I was inspired for my hell of a long time listening to those artists, right? Yes, Steve.
Right. Sound system music has always had this reputation as a kind of underworld music. And some of the places you played in with El Paso were some kind of dangerous places.
Yeah, really and truly, when you have the leading sound system in Jamaica, right, you have some bad guys following the sound, you know, because a bad man love good music or anything that is good. You know what I mean? So when you're playing as and you're the leading sound, then you know, say, you're going to attract a lot of bad men, right? And I used to have a few of them following my sound, right? I used to play in places like Furnace Lawn in Salt Lane, right? Steel Lane was my main base of 3 Mile. Steel Lane, right? I used to play there quite regular, right? Back to, right? All of them places, Red Hills Road, right? Them time, you know, sound like Surf 8 and them sound yet. It's after a while Surf 8 come take over Red Hills Road. But I mean, used to run the roads before, right? With El Paso, right? Well, we're playing at some really dangerous places, as you would say. But at the time, when we're playing the sound, it didn't look that way to me, you know? But looking and from the outside and looking in now, you can say the place was really and truly hot, you know what I mean? Yeah, man, we used to have people like Old Man Marshall with my son, and we used to have Sal. At them time, the Junjo Lars and them man used to follow the set, because Junjo, them come from Mackay Lane with Mojo and them man, Bublins. A lot of them man up in the lane there, you know what I mean? Tough guys. Yeah.
Tell us a story about going to the movie and dubbing yourself Al Capone.
Yeah, well, I get the name Dennis Al Capone by that name is a name that grow. It's like it was born from a baby and it grew to be a name, you know, because it all started one night when we went to the movie Majestic Theater, and was coming home me and my friends, and this guy, no, some guy crack a joke, you know, and I was laughing, right? And the guy said to me, look how I'm going on like a pokoni, right? Whatever a pokoni is, I don't know, right? And from that, them start calling me pokoni, right? Then somebody would change one now to Capone, right? Some of them would call me macaroni, right? Until somebody just start calling me Capone, right? Then I put on the Al Capone on it. You know, that's how the name really born. Then from it we say Al Capone, now it just stick. Right? So because they must call me Al Capone, when I leave Keith Hudson and went to Downbeat, I remember that was the alias that they used to call me. So I just tell Coxon, just add Al Capone to Dennis. You know, Dennis Al Capone, that's how the name really came about.
Scratch was good at giving people names, so because there's a story about how he named Dillinger.
Yeah, well, Dillinger used to be with me, you know, with in the sound system. Even just Stitch, you know, we go all about, you know what I mean? Stitch, right? In the early days, Dillinger, I used to give Dillinger the mic, right? And I used to get a lot of cursing for it, because, you know, the people come to hear me, they don't come to hear Dillinger, right? Because Dillinger was just a little youth at the time. Never have no name for himself, right? But Dillinger could DJ, right? So whenever I want a break, you know, go on the corner and smoke a spliff or drink a beer or anything. I just give Dillinger the mic and make him go around the show. Right, because I had Dillinger on the set, Samuel the First, right, what did the version of Rivers of Babylon, and Prince Francis, right? Those are my second, right? So they were there with me at the time. Trinity was in the lane as well, right? And I used to hear some little threat coming from him, right? Them guys said, Trinity is coming to take over my crown. You know, them guys, you know how yard people stay. From your day on top, somebody said them going to come and dethrone you. Just like Jasbo, right? When I was at Studio One, one day I went into Studio One and I hear somebody say, "Why a country boy, I come here for running for that, you know, Dennis." Somebody say, "A country boy?" I say, "Which country boy that?" I say, "Boy, him same name, Prince Jasbo." I say, "Eh?" Anyway, I never say this country boy yet, right? Because him come at the studio when I wasn't there, right? So, all of a sudden one day, now, I go to the studio and I hear them play this track, a version of Skylarking called Crab Walking. Right, so I said, look like this guy really serious, you know. Cause that tune was a hit for him. Now Lizzie, right, them time a lot of people believe jam is a new sound, you know, but jammies was around from Tubby's days. Because jammies are the second best sound in the island at the time. King Tubby's was the best sound, then jammies. Because I think Tubby's, I'm not sure, but I think Tubby's work on Jammies amplifier as well. At that time, Lizzie was the DJ. And me and Lizzie used to spar, right? And I took Lizzie to Treasure Isle, right? And we did a few songs together. And we ended up doing an album called DJ's Choice of Duke Reed, right? And Lizzie did a single named Love is a Treasure, a Freddie Mackay track that did very well as well.
Yeah, okay. So, how has DJ music changed from the early days when it first started right until nowadays, Dave?
Well, in the early stages, right, you had people like King Sporty, right, Sir Lord Comic, Cuttings and people like those, right? When they was riding on the scary dims, right, they didn't say much. They would more or less introduce the song, right, and they would and ride the rhythm like that, right? And Lord Comic did Sky and West, right, which was a hit. And you can hear Sporty and tune like Guns of Navarone and them songs, you know, boosting it up. And some of Barbara Brooks early music, right, you hear the DJ them going in the background, right? But in those days, DJ never really there wasn't sing talking, right? Then he had King Stitch, now went and did Fire Corner for Clan Circles and Vigat and tune like those tune sell a lot, but they was more classified as instrumental, even though Stitch was on it, right? Now until you right now did Wake the Town and Tell the People, and a new sound was born in Jamaica, just like what he said, Wake the Town and Tell the People, because we wake up one morning and there was Uri mashing up the whole place. We'd Wake the Town and Tell the People. And that's how the whole thing was really born, the whole DJ business. Right, but at that time, I was working on El Paso, right, but not recording. Right, and Uri was working with Tubby's. But Uri was riding the Rocksteady Rhythms, right? Like myself, I came on the Rocksteady Rhythms. Now, when the music changed now is when the drum and bass thing, right? Like what Big Youth, come on. People like Big Youth and Stitch afterward, right? That's when it changed over. But dub music on a whole, right? Dub music was started by King Tubby's, right? Because Tubby's used to buy the acetate from Duke Reed and Coxon, right, by the raw rhythm, right, on a dub plate, right, and when that playing the dance hall, it caused a big riot, you know what I mean? Because it was something new. You know, you'd be playing the vocal of a song, right? And the DJ would take it up and say, lick it back from the top, right? And put it back again. And all of a sudden, when it come back, you hear no voice. It's pure rhythm. Then the dancehall would explore, you know, pure noise and thing. And, you know, everybody loved that, right? Our first dub plate that we bought from Jukeweed was a song that Melodians did, Everybody Ballin', right? It was a fortune was on the the acetate. Everybody Ballin', Alibaba, and a John Oates, I Didn't Come to You, Darling, right? And every day is an holiday, Sensations, right? And when we play those tunes in the dance hall, right, I'm telling you, it's just madness, you know? Everybody just love it. And that's how dub plate really born. You know, them time you never used to get rhythms and 45. 45 used to have A and B side, right? And it's when the producers now hear about the impact that these things having in the dance hall that they decided to start putting rhythm and as a B-side of records. Well, a lot of people talking today about dancehall music, right? But dancehall music was from before I was born, right? The dancehall was there, right? Like I say, it started from people like Cuttings and people like Machuki and Stitch and them people, right? Dancehall was from then, not today, right? And dancehall is the biggest exposure for the reggae music. Because really and truly, there's a lot of reggae music that you don't hear on the radio in Jamaica. Right? Because sometimes you turn on the radio, it's like it's monopolized by foreign music. You know, some of most of the hardcore music is an underground thing. Right? It's only in the dance hall you can hear it. You know, because if you don't, as a producer, if you don't have the money to pay the radio disc jockeys, then you don't get no earplay. You know, so most of those songs, you hear them in the dancehall, right? So dancehall have been the biggest influence on the music so far, and the DJs in the dancehall, right? Most of the artists, them bust out through the dancehall, right? Mark, you know, if you play an advertisement on the radio, the advert will become a hit because people keep on hearing it. You know, so any record you play on the radio over a period of time, people is gonna go out and buy it because they keep on hearing it. Right, but like I say, it's very few people, right, that get that choice. You know, most of the people them now is just coming from the underground, playing them the music in the dance hall. That's where they get the exposure. A lot of these are artists, today artists, right? It's not the radio that burst them out. It's dance hall, cassettes. You know, say even in foreign. Right? Why you hear? What the first place I hear Shabba was on a dancehall cassette, right? The first place I hear King's Lieutenant Stitchy was on a dancehall cassette. You understand? So dancehall was and is the thing that break out artists over the years. You know, everything happened in the dancehall. Let's give some intro.
Yeah, give me a selection.
From the number one station, here comes the power version. One intro. You said you're the best, but when I'm around, you're the second best. And if you don't believe it's true, all you got to do is try I. Hook, line and sinker. Hook back, Spanish Amiga. Plate back, Jack. You got to graduate before you go through the gate. Ting-a-ling, ting-a-ling. I hear the school bell ring. Hear the school bell ring. Ting-a-ling, ting-a-ling. You can hear that lyrics says Shabba, they take it and do it. Do him one thing with it, you know? But it's my origination. You know what I mean? Yeah. I hate that.
Right.
Fire in a shot now.
Yeah, brilliant. In that period when you came up there, were there many bad boys and rude boys around the music?
Yeah, man, there's always rude boy in Jamaica, man, right, from ever since, you know. Them days in the early 70s, you had people like Spanglers, Toughies, Pigeon Gang, Spade Gang, right, and a few others. Pigeon used to follow a sound named Sir Mike, the musical dragon from in Toil. Yeah, a lot of people believe that Bob Marley just bust out in the 73, 74 era, but Bob Marley was singing Rude Boy tune from in the early 60s. You know, you had tune like, why, give me a little soul, oh Lord, give me a little soul. You have Rudy come from jail, cause Rudy get bail. And them time, not the dance hall now, when people hear them songs, it wasn't gunshot or fire. Man used to break buckle and say, iron. You know, lick down the buckle upon the ground and it's pure buckle here around you. And man a ball iron. Right, the rude boy in them days. One and two man did have gun and thing, and the girls them used to carry them ice pick and thing, you know what I mean? Right, so rude boy thing a go on long time, you know? Yeah, for real. So a long time rude boy business about, you know, only thing depend on a different level, you know, is M16 and Glock and all kind of different high power weapon, you know. But long time ago.
Did you see any incidents?
Yeah man, don't talk about incident man. I've seen enough man, right? I'm telling you. At one stage in the dance hall in Jamaica, the dance just couldn't go on. Because if it's not the rude boy, I mash it up, it's the police. If it's not the police, it's the soldier. You know, and it reached that stage where one time, dance hall have a cool out. Because even Tubby's, the mash up Tubby's sound system, the police them, mash it up clean. You know, because some of them, if them come to the dance and tell them must lock off, and if you don't want to lock off, you know what I mean, they put all them button in a yamper fire and all them with it, right? So, with the rude boy business dance hall now, it's enough shot fired in them days as well. You know, I can't remember one incident. I was playing, my mic that I was using is a very sensitive mic, right? And a guy behind me, where I was DJing, fire shot in the ear, right? For some reason, right? And the you must know the mic pick up the sound of the shot and echo it through the steel on. And everybody tear down the place and gone, right? And a man, take the mic from me and ball out, say, no, come back to the dance, not no wrong. Is a man a pumping bicycle and the tire bus, right? Yeah, but them know who the fire the shot, a brother named Lazarus. And the guy know I keep the dance now, a brother named Coffee Tea, who passed away now, right? Him go look for Lazarus the following day. And him find him in a Chinese cemetery. And kill him same place. For mash up him dance, you know? Yeah. So a whole heap of violence used to go on at them time there, you know? Two new more to mention.
Just give us one more. The one about the woman who got stabbed when you were DJing on the mic right next to you.
Oh yes, one night I was playing the sound run by Oakland Crescent. And this bad man was asking this girl for a dance, you know? And she didn't want to dance with him. Right? And him vexed for that. So him grab her and she run. Right? And him run after her and she dropped right on my foot. Right? While I was DJing. Right? And him take out him knife and start stab her. Right? And her sister jump on him. Right? And hold him round him neck and I ride him on him back and him flash her off and the girl get up and run out through the dance hall gate and that saved her. And she was pregnant as well, you know. But she didn't actually dead because her sister saved her life. Because there's nothing I could have do, you know, because I'm just there to DJ and them man they are some very serious man, you know. Them no ramp. Them man the guns no argue, you know what I mean? A woman have a better chance. Arrested with them man there, you know. Yeah, there was always violence in the dance hall. From ever since.
But it was also a place of niceness.
Yeah man, well, when it nice, it well nice, you know. Violence wasn't a regular thing. But it was always there. But you have more nice time more than bad times. Because nice times, you know, make up for the bad times. Right, because when dance go on nice, it go on nice, you know. Because we had some good locations like Port Henderson Beach, Copacabana, right, Gold Coast, and them places when we go at them dance there. Dance on the mic now. And what I was doing now, everybody loved it, you know. And it reached a stage now where I was mashing up the place, you know, taking over the whole.